Good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, if you're joining us today from India. My name is Basil. I work at the EADI in Bonn in Germany. So we are the European Association of Development and Training Research Institutes. So if you're not familiar with us, we work in improving the visibility of development studies throughout Europe and promoting cooperation between our members across countries. We are primarily Europe-based, as the name indicates, but we also organize seminars with participants from all over the world, as today. We organize both physical and online events. Of course, with the current situation, our presence is stronger online, and I encourage you to check all our lineup of virtual talks on the website. If you're based in India or are interested in India, I also encourage you to look and register for our event on the 28th of September, which will look at Kerala and the response of Kerala compared to other states in the Indian context. You can also check our previous virtual dialogue on our channel on YouTube. So it's simply EADI channels. And all the events are listed on our website, and that is eadi.org. And you can register for free to all our events there. One last word about our organization. I would encourage you to follow us through our newsletter, which you can sign up for online. This is a bi-monthly newsletter with lots of information about our seminars, about publications from our member institutes, job ads, and so on and so forth. So enough about us. Let me switch to today's talk. So it is our great pleasure to welcome Dr. Sudha Narayan, from IGIDR in India. So Sudha is Associate Prof, and she is interested in agricultural and development economics. Today, she will present some findings from recent research on the resilience of food systems in India during the COVID pandemic. The talk will last for about 20 minutes and will be followed by 40 minutes of Q&A and discussion. Okay, Sudha, so the floor is yours. So you now have 20 minutes and you can share your screen. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. And I'm going to just share my screen right now. So as I said, it's a pleasure to be here. And I particularly like discussions where the presentation is shorter than the time available for discussions, because I think with the online format, I feel like we've had very interesting, where I've shared my work with other forum. It's been very interesting. The discussions have been far more informative than the presentation itself. So I hope we'll take advantage of that today as well. So my work is based on a series of a set of studies that we've been undertaking since March, and we continue to work on these issues. So what I'm going to present to you today is a kind of a summary of different perspectives. And I want to say upfront that India is a complex country, very diverse, and there's a lot of heterogeneity. So what I hope to do in my talk is to give you a big picture view, and a lot of them that I would consider generalizations. And I'm hoping that the nuances and the particular details will come through in any discussion we might have. So I'm going to keep a lot of the nuance and the detail for the discussion and focus purely on the big picture. The title is Food Chain Resilience in India, which kind of gives it a positive ring, but actually it's a double-edged story where there is resilience, but also a lot of vulnerability. So if there's one take-home message from today's talk, I would be that I would say that my discovery in the research that we've been doing is that India perhaps has resilient agri-food chains, but a very vulnerable population. So that's the message I hope to leave you with. My presentation is not going to be very linear, but I'm going to sort of cut through layers and share with you evidence from two sets. So one, we are using publicly available secondary data on markets and prices. And price will be the lens through which I look at a lot of these issues. But we are going to complement it with surveys, so telephonic surveys with farmers, as well as face-to-face surveys with food retailers to kind of fill in the gaps and understand the whole. With this, I'll get started. So for those of you who are not aware of the background in India of the COVID-19 crisis, here's a graph that shows how the cases have been evolving. So even at the beginning, the first case was detected on January 31st. And even early on, people were anticipating both a health crisis and an economic crisis. And in many cases, you would expect that a pandemic itself generates economic consequences. But in the case of India, the action that was taken to contain the health crisis was actually very severe. And India took very early action. So the first case was on January 31st. And if you look at the graph and you try to guess where the lockdown came, you'd be tempted to put it quite far away from when the cases are rising. But the just to give you an indication of when the lockdown happened, it was actually at this point of time. So it was 26th March. 24th March was when the lockdown started. So when the cases were really very few, the lockdown was imposed. And it was a very stringent lockdown. And it was enforced with an iron hand by policemen locally. So which meant that a lot of the activity that came to a standstill. Now, one of the interesting things and unfortunate things about the Indian lockdown was that it happened at very short notice. So 4 hours after the announcement, the lockdown came into effect. So to give you a sense of how little time people had to prepare, fishermen in Mumbai who had gone out to fish weren't aware of the lockdown. But when they came back with their catch the next morning, they couldn't sell it. And an estimated 1 million tons of supply was lost overnight. Across the country. Likewise, truck drivers who were traveling on the highways literally had to stop and they abandoned their vehicles and left home. So you have that kind of a lack of preparedness for the lockdown. So it came as a surprise. Now, because of when the lockdown was announced and because of where we are today, as of yesterday, I think India was reporting over 80,000 new cases. And that seems to be the range in which the last 10 days we have seen the number of new cases. And it seems that actually the economic crisis hit well. And then the health crisis is actually, we are yet to see the full force of the health crisis. So in some sense, India is not in a good position. So so we do have an economic crisis and it's official. So as of yesterday and day before yesterday, the last 2 days have seen the release of the official GDP data, that's quarter on quarter. And the Indian economy we know has contracted by 23.9%. And it's evident that among all the G20 countries, this might be the worst performance of any economy. But here there is... I think many observers have pointed out that despite all of this bleak figures with economic performance, agriculture offers a ray of hope. And the growth rate of agriculture has been it's been the only sector that's registered positive rate of growth, and it's at 3.4%. And usually agriculture in India lags behind other sectors, but this is the first time in many, many years that agriculture has done well, whereas the other rest of the economy is doing badly. Why is this significant? Because unlike most emerging economies, as well as certainly developed countries, agriculture is quite a critical part of the Indian economy. Even though it accounts for 15% of the GDP, which itself is quite much higher than what the developed countries have. Almost 50% of the workforce derives some income from agriculture. So good news in agriculture is actually portends well for the economy as a whole. The other thing that's cited often is that when the lockdown happened in March, that was when the winter crop was being harvested and the production was very healthy and better than usual. So today in India, food grains is around 295 to 300 tons and horticulture is actually a much larger proportion recently, which is high value and is an important source of income. So that's 320 million tons. So production was higher than usual. And other positive indicators that are given is that once the harvest of the winter crop was over, we have the rains in the summer. And this is when all the sowing is completed. August is the month when we know for sure how much area has been sown. And we know that the area under major crops has expanded by around 7% relative to last year. So these are all shown as evidence for agriculture doing well. And there is some truth to this. I think India's structure of agriculture and the agri-food supply chains has endowed it with some characteristics that actually enable resilience. And I think that's worked to cushion the impacts in some sense. One is that the winter season, which is called the Rabi season in India, is actually rain-fed agriculture in the sense that the winter crop only grows where you either have access to irrigation or where the rains have been so good that there is enough soil moisture to support an extra crop. So, and that's not true of most of India. So an estimated 51% of the area under cultivation in India falls under rain-fed conditions. So a lot of farming communities actually don't farm this season. So in some sense, any shock to the supply chain would affect only a subset of the farmers. So in a way, that worked to its advantage. But there are issues that I will talk about a little later in terms of what do farm households face. So that's one part. The second part is the extreme institutional diversity in India in these agri-food supply chains. So for one thing, India does not have factory farms of certainly of the scale of the US, but also relative to Europe, we have fairly small farms, and almost 85% are small and marginal farmers who own less than 2 hectares of land. Many of them are actually what you would call peasant households and rely on family labor rather than hired labor. And many of them grow for self-consumption. So this characterizes agriculture by and large, and we don't have that kind of industrial agriculture with long supply chains. So this is one aspect of farming that is useful to know. The other thing is the agro-based industry. Just like we have a dominance of smallholder agriculture, India has huge mix of presence of micros and small medium enterprises in the food processing and food distribution sector. It is not as if we don't have large scale industries. They are large, and the large ones are quite large, although not to the scale in which we see the global conglomerates. For example, the largest dairy industry player in India is the cooperative dairy. And in the top 20 in the global list, they don't feature there. And in fact, Nestle and all of them, the larger players in the dairy sector, for instance, will have a 7 to 10% turnover of Nestle. So that way, even the large scale in India is not in the sense of large scale globally. But we do have a large mix of players, and there's an estimated 21 million enterprises that dot the agro-based industries. And coming to the retail end, I'm not sure if there is any official statistic, but our understanding of the composition of retailers, it's a very complex mosaic, with approximately 90% form traditional food retails. So they are informal largely, but with an increasing formalization that's happening, where formal essentially means you're registered and you pay taxes and you're in the tax radar. So even if many of them are formal, they are still very small scale, they are hyper-local, and they are quite traditional in the way they operate. For example, the backbone of the food retail sector is the Kirana stores, and the Kirana essentially refers to mom and pop stores or hyper-local brick and mortar stores. Depending on which country you're in, they're called different things. In India, the typical thing is the Kirana store, and they're usually family run enterprises and very small. They operate out of a very small space, and they have a huge mixture of traditional and global brands, so they are quite a mix. And there are a lot of street vendors as well, and the street vendors typically retail fresh produce. And only 8% is modern retail, and online grocery is a really small percent. Industry estimates that at most 2% is online, but some industry observers actually put it at 0.1%. Even though it's a very fast growing segment, it doesn't count for much at the moment. So these are the characteristics that have helped, and one needs to understand this mosaic of actors to understand why Indian agriculture was resilient during this time. At the same time, and I want to come to the negative aspects, we know that the farm sector pretty much unraveled because of the lockdown. So if you start from farm to fork, the farming operations were a problem because farmers couldn't even reach their fields because the local law enforcement and policemen were preventing access to their farms. Availability of labor was a problem in many of the well-developed Green Revolution states in India, which depend on hired labor. It depends on hired migrant labor from distant states, especially states in eastern India. And because many of the migrants chose to return home, availability of labor was a problem, as was access to machinery, which is typically hired. Then there were mandi closures. Mandis are actually regulated government-operated fresh markets where farmers typically come, and that's usually the first point of sale, where farmers sell to traders. And these are called mandis, and these were actually closed off and on, and there was a lot of uncertainty, and they also became high risk areas because of crowding. And village traders stopped coming. They were reluctant to procure because there was all of this uncertainty. And if they were procuring, they were offering very low prices. And transport challenges were huge. Cost doubled, and truckers were not reluctant to ply because they could not get food on the highways. Warehouses, cold storages faced labor constraints. Agro-processors were operating below capacity. Many of the oil crushing was, they were operating only at 30 to 50% of capacity. And on the demand side, at the retail end, Horeca, which is hotels, restaurants, and catering services, the demand collapsed, and exports also were hit quite badly. In April, especially. And for plantation crops, livestock, poultry, fisheries, the animal sector was particularly badly hit, especially in the early days when the rumors were that COVID-19 was spread via poultry. So they took a huge hit. And these were the kind of challenges in the initial part, partly because of the lockdown and the inability of the food chain players to actually prepare for the lockdown. I'm just going to give you evidence from different secondary sources to give you the scale of the problem. So even though we think of agricultural sector as a ray of hope today, I think there's more to it than meets the eye. And here are the mandis, which are the official markets where farmers sell their produce. If you look, I mentioned that there were intermittent closures of the mandis. And if you look at it near the lockdown, basically only less than a fourth of the mandis were operating on a given day. And although until May 31st, the lockdown was there nationally, and lockdowns are still continuing partially in many states and districts. And you see that even though many more mandis are opening today, it's still below what is usually there during this time. So this is for sort of evidence for mandis not being fully operational yet. And if you look at the market arrivals, how much are the farmers bringing to these mandis? So we are looking at 40 major crops that account for about 85% of area under grains and 60% of the area under horticulture. If you look at the mandi arrivals, note that in the April, if you look at the previous years, which are the gray lines, that's when the winter harvest comes into the markets. So you would expect peak arrivals to happen in April. And you see the black line, which is the 2020, is again about half of the usual mandi arrivals. So this is aggregated over 40 crops. There are a lot of differences across crops between perishables and non-perishables. I won't go into that. But it's clear that when the harvest season was at its peak, the lockdown actually did affect arrivals negatively. And the reason these arrivals are important is because it's a very rough proxy for how much of the production, which was very healthy, as I mentioned, how much of it translates into farmers' incomes. And we have evidence from different studies that show that many people held back and didn't sell their crop, for example, cotton, because of mandi closures as well as collapse in prices. So this is the slide where we've just computed a producer price index, which again aggregates prices over these 40 crops, and prices pretty much crashed to, I mean, in some cases they were 1/4 of the price pre-lockdown. In other cases, it was 50%. But overall, in the immediate 2 months after the lockdown, prices had crashed. So if you have arrivals stopping and the prices stopping, even though the aggregate figures in agricultural growth look positive in terms of income or its translation into income, we are not quite sure how the farmers were doing. And existing evidence from this seems to suggest that farmers have actually been badly hit. Now, I want to now go from farmer to the other end of the spectrum, which is the retail end. And what essentially has happened, and this is based on the evidence that you're seeing, is that the collapse in demand in the retail sector, that is in the big cities, the closure of restaurants, that collapse in demand has got transmitted in the form of lower prices and lower demands to the farmers. And going the other way, all the transactions costs, the increased transportation costs, the uncertainties, all of the cost increases because of the transportation and logistics bottlenecks, the cost increases have got passed on to the consumers. So the middlemen in the supply chain have protected themselves by passing on the decrease in prices to the farmers and increasing the prices to the consumers. And that's the part I'm going to show you now. So even though a decline in farmers' prices, you would expect it to be transmitted to the consumers in the form of lower prices, especially because there's lower demand now, you don't see that. And in fact, consumer prices have been rising quite quickly in cities. And this price index that we've computed, the top half is the retail price and the bottom half is the wholesale price index. And these are a combination of 22 commodities across 114 urban centers. So this is what is happening in urban areas. I have less to say about what's happening in rural areas because we don't have publicly available data. But you see that immediately after the lockdown, prices increased. They seem to be improving. And then as the COVID health crisis has set in and the cases have increased, and it's also the monsoon season and the sowing season, so the previous season is over, you again see a rise in consumer prices. Now, again, as I said, this is a big picture. Different things are happening in different places. But a couple of things that are evident is in the early days, the wedge between the wholesale and retail prices. So the price difference between wholesale and retail really shot up. And that's usually symptomatic of high costs of operation in distribution. And so we saw a very huge increase in the price wedge, and that's kind of eased out now. But more importantly, we see a spatial fragmentation. So what's happened is when free movement is permissible, then you would expect prices to even out. But what's happened is suddenly that one whole Indian food market has got splintered or fractured into many small markets. So this fragmentation means that the price in, say, Mumbai, where I stay, is very different from the prices that are 200 kilometers away in another city. So what we are seeing is that the price increase has been to the tune of almost 20% in the smaller cities, and we get a sense that smaller cities have been more badly affected. And this is also related to the fact that in big cities, mandis were still open and there were many players who managed to get produce in, and this is not true of the smaller cities. Now, when you look at animal products, I think we have very contrasting situations depending on what product you're talking about. We found that chicken prices crashed, as did eggs and milk as well. The milk primarily owing to a collapse in all of the eateries and the demand for processed cheese and things like that. The eggs and chicken are very much to do with the rumor that COVID-19 was linked to poultry. Meat and fish, on the other hand, you see visible price increases. And that's partly been because of the closure of meat markets. And we don't have very sophisticated meat packing industry. These are all mostly informal retailers and butchers, and they have not been able to operate very effectively. And all of these have implications, serious implications for nutritional aspects. And this is something that sort of remains hidden even in the discussion today, because most economists and in India just stop talking about inflation and don't go beyond. But I think nutritionists have repeatedly raised concerns about the prospects for the nutritional status of most net consumers. Now, why has this happened? We had face-to-face interviews with retailers. We did three waves, and these were mostly conducted by student volunteers. We obviously didn't insist that they go and meet them. Wherever possible, they went to the local store to interview them. And they tracked the same retailers as far as possible over three rounds. And while we started with 50 retailers in 14 different cities, we weren't able to track all of them because many of the street vendors had just left home. Many of them were migrants and they could not be found. Some of them shifted location. So this has to be taken with a pinch of salt, but this is just to get an idea of the kind of issues that came up. In the early days, getting supplies itself was quite hard. 58% of reported that was the problem. These eased, and the transport availability has also eased. But what you see hasn't eased is that the costs of transport remain high. And many of them continue to report that they have to pay traders very high prices to get the supply. Labor shortage still continues because a lot of the agri-food supply chain is really maintained and supported by migrant labor. And many of you would have seen images of migrant exodus from cities because they had lost their jobs. So I think there were heartrending images of labor migrants leaving the cities. And the shortage has really impinged on agri-food supply chains. One of the things I want to focus a bit on the last two columns on the right, the last three actually. So you see that many actually reported harassment from police and others. So one of the fallouts of this lockdown has been the way it was implemented on the ground, even though all of these are considered essential commodities and all players in the supply chain were supposed to have free access to transport and markets. In reality, this was not the case. And the harassment was quite heavy-handed, and this was one big problem. It continues in some cities, but by and large, we find that in many other cities where the COVID cases are not very high, it's eased. The last two columns are actually a discrimination, and you'll notice that in the first round, we didn't capture this because we didn't anticipate it. But in the context of India, I think the aspect of religious and social discrimination based on ethnicity because of kind of misapprehensions on which communities were actually driving the COVID crisis. There were a lot of rumors again, and this came out quite prominently. And I think it's important for us to recognize that even these agri-food supply chains are not neutral spaces and can be socially very, social discrimination is quite high there. And when we talk of sustainability, I think the social aspect is often forgotten. So I wanted to just highlight that as well. So clearly you see that many people ask, okay, did the traders make a killing because they've passed on the high prices to the consumers and paying the farmers very low? I think it's a bit of both. On average, we feel that some retailers were quite candid in saying, yeah, we charge the consumers very high price because I don't want to bear the cost. Some of them may be actually making a tidy profit on this. But by and large, it seems like the costs have just been passed on to the farmer and consumer, leaving many of the middlemen actually unaffected. But we do find a difference where street vendors say that they have suffered, whereas many of the brick and mortar store owners says they've actually done better because online grocers were not able to function. So here's a bit on the resilience. Actually, I already mentioned that the Indian agri-food supply chain is dominated by traditional players. And there is a notion that economists have that the formalized modern sector is much better equipped to deliver, and especially online retail. You would think that in the time of pandemic, people would turn to online deliveries and they would successfully meet the demand. And unfortunately, in the case of India, what's happened is the demand on online actually increased by almost 30%, but they were not able to meet the demand because of logistics problems. And in fact, the street vendors have done much better. The grocery stores have done much better because there were very low entry barriers. And to give you an example, in a couple of cities in India, we got received information through our surveys that there were as five times as many retail vendors as before, because many people who had lost their jobs, there was a garage mechanic, a car mechanic who had lost his job, he had to shut shop, and he had turned to vegetable vending. Same thing with small newspaper vendors. People had stopped subscribing to newspapers during the immediate aftermath of the lockdown, and they switched to vegetable vending. So in some sense, this informal retailing, because it had low barriers, also attracted more players. And in some sense, that also contributed to the supply chain going on. So now let's go back to the farmers survey, where again, with the help of some student volunteers, we interviewed 370 farmers from 9 states. And as I mentioned, actually many farmers are very smallholders. 39% of them said the lockdown had affected them very badly, and about 20% more said that it had affected them somewhat badly. But one important thing is, in India, 32% of the farming households' income actually comes from wages. So farm income is not enough to sustain a household. So many of them are dependent on jobs. So we find that close to a quarter actually had a household member who lost his or her job. And disturbingly, almost a quarter had to skip a meal or rely on others for food or borrow food. And we are now getting evidence. This was in April, May, but we are now getting reports from different villages saying that a recent survey actually put it at 68% having to skip a meal. And so we are finding that this distress has not gone away. I'm going to skip over this, but you can just see that coping strategies in May, they were just cutting back on expenses. We are again getting reports that many have now begun to sell assets and have borrowed quite a bit to keep afloat. And finding work and earning income, the prospects continue to be bleak, and many of them are just have returned to agriculture. And this is one of the things. So what we were trying to do is to explain this disjunct between what we are seeing in terms of what the data says and what the macro level picture says, that agriculture is a ray of hope. And we do find that even though paying back loans, finding work, earning income, food availability were all problems to different measures, it's not affected continuance of farming operations. So even the initial lockdown, by the time the government realized that this was going to be a serious problem and started taking action, many farmers had already purchased their inputs. And even though they had labor problems, they relied primarily on farm labor. And in places where they hired labor, they were relying on mechanization to actually ensure that farming operations continued. And in some ways, it's a coping strategy because many of them have lost jobs. In fact, we find that the sowing area acreage sown this season is higher, partly because it may be a strategy or an insurance. So agriculture is serving as an insurance mechanism for many people. So this is my last slide. And as I said, the message that I want to leave with you is that Indian food, agri-food supply chains have been resilient due to a variety of factors, but it's not the case that these resilient food supply chains have actually ended well for the participants in these chains. So I would say that it's resilient food chains with the vulnerable population. And what has helped and what has not helped? It's not as if the government was not doing anything about it. We see that in terms of government role, India actually procures lots of food grains, rice, wheat, pulses, oil seeds, and these are all to feed food grain distribution, subsidized food grain distribution through ration shops. And so the procurement was happening in many states, which helped prop up farmer prices, especially for rice and wheat farmers. There were also direct transfers to farmers through a scheme, which is a cash transfer. That was done not so effectively. There were still weak spots, but it was announced. In-kind food grain distribution took place, and many of the loans that farmers owed banks were actually rescheduled. So these were the measures that the state took. But very interestingly, there's also been a lot of private innovation in this space. So informal food retailers, as I said, the Kirana stores, they have actually been supported by a lot of food tech companies that have managed their logistics. So that's going to be something in the future that we are going to see. The involvement of back-end strengthening of supply chains of the informal food retailers. The role of farmer producer organizations and agri-tech firms, they've operated on a fairly small scale, but I think they've begun to do things that they were not doing before. So in some sense, the crisis prompted them to think of new ways of connecting up to their members of their farmer groups, as well as direct sales. So far, farmer produce organizations were just aggregating produce, but this COVID crisis actually pushed them to reach out directly to consumers in big cities. And it's worked out well for them, at least for many of them. And they are now currently seeking to capitalize on their learning and keep it going. So this was the one positive fallout of this crisis. So even though there has been private innovation and public procurement and other government measures, my own sense is that the central government has focused far more on long-term reform, structural reform, than relief. And we are now getting evidence from different telephonic surveys that the relief has been very spotty and has excluded large sections, notably women farmers, for example, and food grain distribution has not been very effective. So the implementation has been quite flawed. But even in terms of design, the measures that have been taken are not really commensurate with the scale of the crisis. And this is something that there's a fairly growing consensus on this. But it also varies widely across states. Again, I said I was going to give you the big picture. What I say to be true all overall is not necessarily true of all the states. And as Basil pointed out, there's going to be a Kerala discussion soon, and you will see that Kerala did it differently. So both agriculture and markets are in a federal structure like India. They are actually the responsibility of the states. So different states have been innovating. I don't have time to go into those, but I'm happy to give a couple of examples in the discussion. But one takeaway is that food insecurity remains high, and we should expect it to remain high. So even though the government is focusing on reform, I think there is still a huge need for relief, and I expect that need to remain for the next year or so. So I will stop there, and I'm happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you very much. So that this was very interesting. Perhaps you can keep your slides on in case people have a question about this. So we now open the chat for questions. Perhaps while people put their thoughts together, I can start with a question. So thank you all for this presentation. This was really interesting, and it was very clearly explained, I thought. And I would like to ask a question about the surveys, these tables here on the previous slides. Just before, yes. So here you mentioned that a lot of farmers have resorted to borrowing for coping strategy, and a lot of them mention paying back loans as a very serious problem. One thing we hear a lot about structural problems in India is farmers' debts issues and infamous problems and issues of suicides this has led to in the farming community. So looking ahead, now that the corona has further strained farmers, do you think there is even more of a concern of potential deeper structural issues regarding loan debts for farmers, and potentially an even wider, well, more events of farmer suicide? What do you think about this?
I think it's a very important question, and I definitely think there is a huge risk. We do see that there were some newspaper reports from credible sources that the number of suicides among farming communities has increased. I should preface that actually with this statement that it's very hard to get precise data from official sources because they no longer report farmer suicide separately. So, but we do see an increase in the number of suicides in particular spots. So it's definitely a fear. And in fact, that's one of the problems of the government strategy, that even though they've postponed loan repayments, most of the effort has come in the form of more credit. So you have credit schemes to enable people to set up food processing. And that's not really what we need. We need something that's more direct, that will enable farmers not to sell their precious assets. Because if they sell assets, then it's going to really push them over the edge. So we need something that will help them support, keep their resource base intact, and just tide over this crisis and before they get back. And I don't see that happening effectively.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. We have another question from Suzanne, who asked if you could give an example of a private innovation that has helped.
So I think I mentioned a little bit about this briefly. So one of the things that the FPOs, farmer producer organizations, have started doing is, until even today actually, they aggregate produce, because there are many smallholders, they aggregate produce and sell it to online grocers, for instance. And because the online grocers were not able to deliver this time, and it had implications for the farmer producers organizations, many of them resorted to WhatsApp and Facebook pages, and to organize and connect to residential complexes. So India has these huge apartment blocks, many of the big cities do. And so they started getting consumers in cities to directly order from them. So this idea of, it's happening at a fairly small scale, but this idea that farmer groups can link directly to consumers is an idea that I think it's taken root in among many FPOs. A second example, which is kind of more technical, is this agri-tech firms. Many of them actually do very sophisticated stock management systems that are in large-scale retail. They are now adapting and innovating for small-scale stores, which have very few stock-keeping units. So they are building models, which they call B2B models, where they procure, source, and pass it on to the Kirana stores or the mom-and-pop stores. And the cost savings and the supply bottlenecks that these small stores face, are apparently there are huge savings there. So that's something that the tech firms in that space have actually reached out to a lot more small scale hyperlocal stores, which I think is like, it's an interesting event, because many people 10 years ago were predicting that organized retail will take over India, but you also see innovation at the hyperlocal small sector. So I think that's an innovation that's here to stay.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, this innovation topic is also grassroots innovation, right? Very interesting. There was one more question by Apurva asking if you noticed any change in cropping patterns, or perhaps expect future changes in cropping patterns following the pandemic.
Again, this is a very good question, because I think the extent to which agriculture sector will recover depends on this. So if I don't know if you kept track of the reports, but in May, all the reports, official reports, was actually celebratory, saying that area sown had grown by 38% and things like that. As of today, August 28th, the data was released, area under major crops is increased by 7%. Now, this doesn't include horticulture. It is true that cropping, more farmers are growing higher acreage. So those who left to work in the city have now come back, and many of them have restarted agriculture. So to that extent, the area sown has increased, but we don't yet know what crops they are growing. We know there's a huge increase in oil seeds, 10%, close to 10% increase in cotton, and these are both are cash crops. But my own sense is that horticulture crops in peri-urban areas, they would continue to grow it, because they know that urban demand will continue to exist in one form or the other. And as the lockdown releases, you are going to get a bit of demand recovering. But in peri-urban agriculture, probably you're not going to see a change in horticulture patterns. But in other places, I think you're going to see a huge shift away from perishables, which again has implications for prices. So my sense is horticulture is getting lower. Non-perishable cash crops are higher. Food grains, especially coarse cereals, are higher. And to me, that's not particularly celebratory, but I get a sense that farmers are watching out for their food security. And related to this, we have some telephonic conversations with farmers in many areas, who are, the smaller farmers are now saying that the larger farmers are actually holding back the grain and not selling it locally, because they are worried for their food security. So one thing is what the cropping pattern changes are. But then going further down, we don't know how much of anything will come into the market and how much will be kept for self-consumption. And then the next step is, if it comes to the market, have prices recovered sufficiently? So these are all the unknowns that we are facing, but we need to track carefully.
Okay, thank you very much. We have one more question here from Natasha, who said, in the context of what you said about agri-tech firms and organized retail, I was curious about your thoughts on how mandis versus private markets and direct buying shaped food supply chains.
I think the mandis, so for those of you who are not familiar with the Indian agriculture supply chains, a lot of the mandi trade happens via regulated markets, which are called mandis. And many states, I mentioned that this is a state subject, so many states allow transactions that to happen outside the mandi, where the farmer can sell directly to a person of his or her choice. But otherwise, usually the farmers expected to sell via the mandi. And until recently, any transaction that happened within a designated area attracted charges that went to the mandi. So there were charges that were levied no matter where the transaction happened. Now, historically, over the last decade or so, the importance of the mandis has been going down gradually because we have new forms of direct procurement, supermarket collection centers, farmer producers organizations, and so on. At the same time, the mandi is very much where all the prices are set and most of the action happens. And I think, so that's one thing. The mandis are still the critical, what economists call price discovery mechanisms. So most people who trade outside the mandis also look to the mandi to see what price something traded there and base their prices off of the mandis. The second thing is the mandis are not just marketing centers. Farmers have very deep relationships with the traders and the commission agents who buy from them. And that's because they actually borrow from them the space that the commission agent or the trader owns in the mandi becomes like a warehouse for the farmer. So I think those are all things that a private trade has found it very hard to dislodge. So to that extent, I think the mandis continue to be a very, very important part of the institutional architecture of agriculture marketing.
I think one more question on government intervention. I think, could you elaborate a little bit of what you think was the most successful or the most unsuccessful government intervention in this regard?
From a farmer's perspective, I think public procurement of grains and pulses and oilseeds is the most effective. And in India, we have very good examples of states such as Odisha and Chhattisgarh, which actually do what is called decentralized procurement. So where a farmer only, they have village-based procurement centers. So the farmer only has to travel to one designated center, which is very close to the field or within the village if possible. And at the most, they have to travel about 15 to 20 kilometers to sell their produce. And these are at guaranteed prices. So these have helped a great deal. And unfortunately, not all states implemented. And the implementation, I mean, a substantial proportion of the procurement is done for wheat, for example, is done in Punjab, Haryana, and Madhya Pradesh. So in terms of geographic spread, it's not as it should be. It's not as equitable as it should be. But wherever states have actually done this decentralized procurement, we see prices have held up a great deal. So in fact, many of us have been advocating that for the next year, it's useful for the government to think of decentralized procurement of horticulture as well. So the crops where you anticipate there's going to be a shortage or high prices for the consumers and low prices for the farmers, it's useful to do decentralized procurement. So procurement has worked well. What has not worked so well are the cash transfers. So the cash transfers to farmers under a program called PM Kisan is only if you have registered farmland. So in most cases, the ownership of land makes me eligible for the cash transfer. And so this excludes a huge share of tenant farmers, and the tenancy is quite large in India. There are also problems with interpretation about how many in a family can get land. So it's typical in India to have as many as 35 people's names on a land record, but not all 35 would be eligible, which means that we had examples from our own survey which said that one brother was eligible, the other wasn't. So I think a recent survey by the NCAER, which is a think tank in Delhi, also suggested that only 60% had received PM Kisan. I'm not exactly clear about what precise figure, but they said that there was a lot of exclusion. So I think these direct payments were not only exclusionary, but they also were, it was quite measly in terms of the amounts. So these were, to me, this was not very useful. It didn't really give the kind of scale of support that the farmers were looking for. So these are just two examples.
Okay, thank you very much. And as time is now running out, perhaps we can have one last question about the state level reality. So you've mentioned you've talked to people in 9 different states, and this provides a perfect transition to our next virtual talk on Kerala by the end of the month. So from a non-national, from a state level point of view, what would you say was perhaps the best example or the worst example? You want to discuss a little bit on the realities at the state level in India?
Yeah, I think one positive example I've already mentioned, like states like Odisha and Chhattisgarh ended up having decentralized procurement of rice in this case. And that's anyway something they were doing historically. But in terms of new innovations in different states, Kerala, for example, when interstate borders shut and milk couldn't travel across states, so the Kerala government took a decision to procure the milk that should have been sold by dairy farmers. They ended up procuring it, but channelizing it to in-kind distribution. So we have childcare centers called Anganwadis, which are for children under the age of 6. And they are given usually rations or cooked food. And they basically channelized whatever they procured to these. So this was a kind of a win-win innovation where the farmers didn't lose out and it was being distributed in kind at a time when milk prices were beginning to rise. So this is one example. Another example is from Tamil Nadu, where Kerala too was doing that, giving kits, grocery kits, because early on these were the hotspots of the COVID-19 virus. And so each family, the government was actually taking care of the distribution where the retail chains had kind of collapsed. So, and in that they included, for Tamil Nadu government, for example, included tea leaves, which kind of supported smallholder tea growers in the Nilgiris, which is a hilly area where tea grows in Tamil Nadu, because the exports had been hit. So I think there are small innovations that different states were doing, and other policies as well. I mean, there were many states that waived cold storage fees for farmers. And some of them had even changed their law to enable private players to procure directly from farmers. So these are some examples. I found particularly that the innovations that ensured that link was not broken, which on the one hand took action to reduce consumer prices or increase the availability of food for them, while supporting farmer prices and ensuring a market for them. I think those have been very useful. And hearsay is that they were innovative, but we don't have concrete evidence to suggest that they had a huge impact. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I think we are sadly running out of time. I see there were a couple more questions. So I would encourage you to read the IFPRI blog post that Sudha has published on the IFPRI blog website, where you might find some answers and more details, or alternatively, perhaps get in touch with the speaker if you have more questions to ask. And that will conclude our virtual dialogue for today. So once again, thank you very much, Sudha. It was great to hear your presentation, and we hope to see some of you again in the future, perhaps on the Kerala seminar on the 28th of September. Thank you very much, and have a great evening or afternoon, wherever you are.
Thank you very much.